unprecedented. I've practiced public health for 32 years and 29 years of those in HIV, AIDS, and I've never seen the continent coordinate itself, collaborate in the highest level, from the highest level to the technical levels. And I'll give you some examples. Nearly every 4 weeks or 6 weeks, President Ramaphosa, in his capacity as the chair of the African Union, convenes his peers. They call it the Bureau of the Head of States, and there are about 15 of them, including the head of states that coordinate the region, the five regions, and they all come together on a Zoom call to discuss COVID. And I do present to them where we are as a continent and the different trends by regions and different trends by countries, and then chart a strategy which they endorse. I think you must have seen some of those communiques. If not, you Google up, you see all of that. That has never happened in the history of infectious diseases, despite the fact that HIV/AIDS kills about 500,000 people on the continent. We've never seen that level of coordination. I think that is one. The second is at a more technical level, what I just described earlier, the kind of work that we do with Chikwe, with Madusa. Chikwe actually coordinates our the task force for infection prevention control. And Amadusa in Senegal, it co-chairs the laboratory technical working group. And we all come together. So the task force that I described meets every Tuesday, but underneath that task force are technical working groups that specialize in special areas, like Mohamed Nusib chairs the risk communication group for Morocco, so that the continent is all covered. We have not seen that before. So that speaks to our ability to collaborate and to coordinate our efforts more and communicate effectively. Then if you see what the diagnostic gymnastics that we went through, when COVID hit Africa, we as a continent had no diagnostic reagents. I'd like to make a distinction between reagents and capacity, because when we say the continent had no diagnostic capacity, it looks like there was no laboratory. That is not true. I mean, we have a lot of sophisticated laboratories, but we just didn't have those reagents for COVID. So this is an intriguing example of a coordination and collaboration on the continent. What we did was simple. We went to a group that was producing these tests in Germany, in Berlin, and we said, look, we're ready to buy the test. And if you recall, the airspace had been shut down at that time. So we had to ship those reagents to Senegal. So Senegal, at the Pasteur Institute, became a depot because the company refused to ship the reagents to Ethiopia, and they could only ship it to South Africa or Senegal. So Senegal became a warehouse that would ship the reagents from Germany to Senegal, and then from Senegal would dispatch it to all over the continent. That is a true symbol of coordination and collaboration and cooperation. I think those are examples that need to be documented in no less manner than the outcome of the response itself. I think there are many examples that I can list, but I think it speaks to the fact that COVID has brought us as a continent more closely than we thought. I mean, we have not seen that level of coordination for malaria TB programs there. For Ebola, we did some kind of coordination because we were in Goma last year, last September to be very specific, and brought all the countries around the DRC together and to develop a joint framework of operation of how we will be responding to Ebola in the sub-region. But it was nothing at this scale, the scale of which we are working to combat Ebola across the continent.
There clearly is, as you say, great coordination happening. On the front lines of healthcare delivery across the continent, and you'll know this much better than I do, once you get out of the big cities, it becomes much, much harder even to get a refrigerator to keep vaccines in, but you know, also electricity to keep surgical blocks working, keep the lights on in hospitals. And you know, medical staff often don't want to work in small towns and villages in the hinterland, which speaks to a wider problem of governance and, you know, building up the capacities of the state to be able to deliver primary healthcare. With your newfound coordination, are you able to advocate this at a continental level to try and get governments across the continent to increase their spend both on basic delivery of primary healthcare, but also on all those other things that you need, like the roads, like the electricity, to keep the lights on in the hospital and that kind of thing.
So, Nicola, let me share my reflections in two dimensions here. First is, as a continent, what are the early lessons that we should be drawing from COVID? And then secondly, what we have to do going forward? I think, again, I need to caveat this and say that it's too early for us to begin to write the history of COVID in Africa. But so what are some of the early lessons? Let me start from that. There is immunization programs have gone down from 84% generally in the world to about 70% in the last 25 years. We now know that poverty levels have gone up. That is, people earning less than $1.9 a day have gone up by 7%, which is a remarkable regression after 20 years of very good work. We know also that the developed world has injected into their economies almost $18 trillion, and as emergency funds. But we also know that by the end of 2021, about $12 trillion might be lost. And lastly, that developed world have injected as part of their GDP about 22% of their GDPs into their emergency spending. And in the developing world, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, we have injected about 3% of our GDP into our emergency funding. So that is there much is a gap that we know that the inequalities that exist and how impactful COVID has. Now, what is the lesson for Africa going forward? For me, what I will be tabling at the African Union using all channels and the EU is clearly that we have to take as strengthening our healthcare systems and healthcare public health system as truly an investment, and that we do not have a chance of fighting another outbreak if we continue to approach it the way that we have done it this time, like rushing and reacting to it. Rather, we should proactively prepare and in several areas. Strengthen our healthcare workers, strengthen our networks of care delivery, and make sure that we see this truly as an investment. See this meaning, see the contributions to strengthening our healthcare systems as an investment. In Abuja, the head of state met in 2013, I believe, or 2002, and committed 15% allocations to their national GDPs to strengthening the healthcare system. We should follow through with those commitments and make sure that it happens, so that we depend on our own resources to strengthen our own healthcare system in a collective manner. I think that is clearly what we are going to be articulating as a new public health order for the continent. And very importantly, that we need to begin to look at local manufacturing of diagnostics, of pharmaceutical products like vaccines and treatment, to the extent that never again should we be scrambling and going to Germany to carry reagents in a suitcase to go to Senegal to train people on the continent of 1.2 billion so that they can protect their people. It's simple. Manufacturing diagnostics is not difficult. I'm very hopeful and very pleased to see the evolution that is happening, where about five countries are now developing diagnostics for COVID on the continent. That is Senegal, Nigeria, Ethiopia just launched a vast manufacturing process to, and their target is to go to about 25 million tests for COVID. That will serve Ethiopia and the rest of the continent, Kenya and South Africa and Morocco. So the key question is, where were we? Okay, I think as we move forward, we should look backward and learn from history and say, never again should we be challenged that much. I think it all just requires prioritization and recognizing that disease threats will occur again, that we will win this battle against COVID-19, and that there will also be another pandemic, and we don't need to be scrambling and like we've done at this current moment. So I think overall, strengthening our health system using a new public health order approach is going to be significant for us going forward as a continent.
You've won this award. Congratulations. Would you like to dedicate it to a person or to a cause?
I would like to dedicate this award to the incredibly hardworking people of and staff that work with me day and night at the Africa CDC. This has been a test of our own existence as a young organization. Recall, we are less than 4 years old, and I was never ever expecting that as a young organization we will be able to come together to coordinate the response on the continent at this scale, and with the young talented people that I work with day in, day out. They work long hours, they stay with me here to 9 p.m. in the evening. I doff my hat to them and dedicate this award to all of them.
That's all for this week. Our thanks to Dr. John Nkengasong, and congratulations once more. Don't forget to visit theafricareport.com for more of our podcasts and sign up to our daily briefing. We'd appreciate it if you could find a moment to rate and review Talking Africa on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts. It really helps others to find us. I'm Nick Norbrook. Thanks for listening.